Abaco Abaco Empowerment and Development Foundation, which was founded by Chief Amobi Nwokafor, PhD, FCA MFR, has organized a World School Debating Championship program. The maiden edition of this debating championship for private secondary schools in Anambra State involves many schools drawn from the state. Some of the schools that attended included the Master School Oka, Prudent Tutoys Secondary School Newi, Progressive Comprehensive College Ifitedunu, Petran Christum International School Isuaniocha, Mount Olive College Umuya, Triumphant Cross School Oba, and Prosperity Learners Academy Mpoago. The coordinator, Pastor Benson Ibe, said the program was aimed at promoting culture and dialogue, as well as also to promote debates in private schools.
This, the foundation, is like I told you, it's an NGO, and just like the name suggests, is an empowerment and development, essentially mostly youth. So it's interested in developing youths and bringing out their potentials for better future. So. And then what actually motivated this project is that we discovered that private schools are kind of lagging behind in the area of debating, which is an essential aspect of the school curriculum. So lagging behind in the sense that currently the present trend in debates follows a format that is quite different from the traditional, and that format is known as World Schools Debating Championship style. So, but it seems that it's only the public schools that are actually using that, that have adopted that, and most of the private schools seem to be quite unaware of that development. So we discovered that gap and decided that it's an area that is necessary to come into, to make some intervention. So that's why the program was launched.
Also, Dr. Amobi Nwokafor, founder of Abaco Abaco Foundation, was represented by Roy Ekunife.
Definitely, you'll queue in and you'll bring our colleagues, awards, and other good tidings to the Anambra, just like the public schools. I wouldn't want to waste some of your time. On that note, I want to welcome everybody for coming, gentlemen of the press, all the schools here, on behalf of Abaka Abako, Ozo Karifof, Dr. Amobi Nwokafor, FCA, MFR. I welcome all of you and then declare this session open. And I want to say that make the best of it, and I congratulate the winners in advance.
The first topic of the debate was on making education free in Nigeria from kindergarten to tertiary level by Prudent Tutoys Secondary School, Newi, why Prosperity Learners Academy, Mpoago, opposed it.
In full support of the Nobel Convention, we back up reasons and points to buttress our arguments. I, the first speaker, will first and foremost give the concept of the contents contained in the above motion, then proceed by highlighting some of the benefits of free education. The second speaker will also speak of some other benefits of free education, such as economic growth, low student debt, more students, more graduates. Then the third speaker will also speak on benefits of free education, like reduction in crime, high literacy level, freedom to choose career course. Finally, we'll end our argument with a request speech, which will be done by you. According to Oxford Advanced Learners Dictionary 6th edition, it states that education is a systematic training which involves giving out instructions for the development of one's knowledge, ability, characters, and mental power, which results to human development. Well, in Nigeria, education is divided into four sectors. They are kindergarten, formerly known as the nursery education, the primary education, the secondary education, and the tertiary education, like the universities, polytechnics, and colleges of education, etc.
I and my teammates are strongly against this proposition. Firstly, I, the first speaker, would like to elaborate the meaning of free education and give you some points why I say it shouldn't be free from kindergarten to tertiary. Then my colleagues will also enlighten you on some points. I proceed. According to Google, free education is basic education that is funded or provided by government or charitable organization rather than tuition funding. Free education has many weaknesses, but I'll focus on just few points. Firstly, the quality of free education is not all that good, because government or even charitable organizations cannot fund all educational institutions in Nigeria, which can cause lack of important resources or understaffing, which would benefit students. So what is the use of the free education when it seems beneficial to students? Furthermore, free education can cause lack of certified teachers, lack of adequate infrastructural educational materials, overcrowding in schools, and lack of inadequate funding to schools. Countries like Zambia are witnesses to this. In addition, when the UPE was declared by the Action Group government in the then East Western region, that was led by late Chief Abekemi Awolowo in 1955, people's enrollment in that region in 1954 was 457,000. But when the UPE was launched, it increased to 811,000. Also,
how can you graduate and get employed? If a country wants this kind of workers, like educated workers in their economy, in order to pump their economy, how will they get them? It's by making education free so that more students will go to school, graduate and get employed. The second benefit of free education is low student debt. We all know that student debt is one of the worst type of debt because it involves frequent increasing in high fees and additional drawbacks. You will see in university, a student going to school, and when he or she has financial crisis, he will go out to borrow, and at the end, get he or herself in trouble. But if Nigeria wants to alleviate this kind of trouble, it's by making education free, thereby alleviating students of their financial strain.
All it takes to fund free education, because to my best knowledge, we have mineral resources that can fund free education. Only crude oil can fund free education. So how can you say that Nigeria don't have all it takes to fund free education?
Free education is the best thing a country can offer to its citizens, and it has so many benefits, which I will mention. There are 1, economic growth. Free education leads to steady economic growth because new innovative ideas will be born by students who enjoy its benefit. A country is more productive economically because of their high proportion of educated workers. So, show me a country that is more vibrant and productive economically, and I will show you a country that is made up of graduates. There are so many countries that practice free education in the world today, and they are economically stable. Countries like Switzerland, Canada, Germany, etc., and so on. So, Nigeria can practice free education. We all know that Nigeria is a blessed country. We have mineral resources, and we have all it takes to make education free in Nigeria. Now, tell me, have you ever seen a country that have invested on education and their economy is crippled? You can never see such thing, because education is the key that leads to a nation change. If you doubt me, then go and search. If you doubt me, go and search a country that invests on
kindergarten to tertiary. First, the free education can lead to decline in the quality of education. This is because the government may not be able to provide the same level of funding and resources as free institutions. As a result of this, the quality of education must be compromised and leading to decline in value of education. Ultimately, paid institutions are often funded and have access to more resources, which leads to better facilities, more diverse course offering, and also make the students to have high quality programs tailored to the student needs and interests.
It aligns with the Sustainable Development Goals set forth by the United Nations in order to ensure free and fair education. But before I go into the benefits, I heard my opponent say that free education cannot be funded by Nigeria, but I want to prove it to her that Nigeria has all it takes, be it crude oil, be it tea, petroleum, we have everything.
All protocols do the opposite. My name is Anne Olubechi Solulare, and I'm here to oppose the proposition that this house would not make education in Nigeria free from kindergarten to tertiary institution. Free education was first proposed in Nigeria, or was first introduced in Nigeria, by Leji Obafemi Awolowo in 1955. But as long as this proposition was, it fell through for many reasons, ranging from inadequate infrastructures, insufficient resources to other socio-economic factors. So what guarantee do you and I have that this same proposition would not fail to? And let us also consider the fact that this free education might cause us to burn our candles at both ends about we have the resources like crude oil. But I want to ask you something. This crude oil you are talking about, is it being refined in Nigeria? Capitally, it's refined outside, right? Okay. Now bringing it back to this Nigeria, it costs more. Now look at where we need fuel, gas, everything is costly. Now how does this even benefit? We cannot even provide this in our own economy.
So whatever is given free, practically and even naturally, is not cherished. Because whatever is given free, practically and naturally, is never cherished. Specifically addressed is already existing educational disparities. In Nigeria, we already have existing significant, we will not change it. Rather, it's become a very heavy burden and load of government, which will be very detrimental to our country's economy. So I still stand saying that this house will not make education in Nigeria free from kindergarten to tertiary. Thank you.
Problem. But concerning that, I will have to teach them. Look, when you give this free education, like, can you even think anything that is being given for free can never, will never be valued? You should know that. What you work for, you sweat for, you value that the most. And I personally value that the most. Giving something free can never benefit you, and you yourself know it. And all of us know it. So teachers, that we have to teach them. Imagine, okay, now they're all in strike.
The title for the second debate is to make all secondary schools boarding schools by Petran Kriskum International School, Isuaniocha. While Triumphant Cross School, Oba, opposed it, Petran Kriskum International emerged the winner.
This brings me to one of the points I'm going to say today. Now, for clarity's sake on this question, boarding school is a formal institution where learners are lodged in a confined school environment and are provided with meals and other basic amenities such as water, electricity, security, as well as trained personnel who serve as student guidance, who are often referred to as patrons or school parents to the students. Now, to propose this motion, I'm going to be talking about how boarding schools encourage punctuality and regularity of students to school. I'm also going to talk about how boarding schools instill in students necessary core values. Also, boarding schools allowing for relative concentration of students on their studies. And lastly, boarding schools as a platform for national integration. My first supporting speaker is going to talk about how boarding schools give students adequate time to study, independence inculcated on boarding students, boarding schools encouraging personal development, and presence of staff expert guidance in the boarding house. While lastly, my second supporting speaker is going to clash the points made by the opponent and speak briefly on discipline. Now to begin with, boarding schools schools encourage punctuality and regularity to the school. This is obviously due to the close proximity of the boarding students to the school block. They usually never miss lessons or skip or come late to school because of the hostel masters usually direct them to the classes early.
And I'm here to oppose the motion which states this house will make all schools in Anambra State boarding school. Before I proceed, I would like to give the definition of boarding school system and day school system. The day boarding school is a school system where students live on campus or within the school premises, attend classes during the day, and carry out extracurricular activities deemed necessary by the school management. While day school, on the other hand, is a system of education in which a child is commuted to school during the day and return home in the afternoon or evening for other activities. In line with the stipulation of this motion, as proposed by my friends in argument here, I am in total disagreement with this motion, owing to the following facts and evidence. Abolishing the day school system will be extremely disruptive for both students and parents. The cost of setting up alternative education system will be high. Day school offers flexibility that boarding school does not.
They do not serve enough food to the students. This is because there are many students present in the school, so they may not be able to provide enough food for the students.
What my colleague has said, I am here to further convince you that making all schools in Anambra State boarding school will have a damnable effect on society. Many children have special needs or require extra support that you can only get at home. Boarding school may not be able to provide the same level of care. So making all schools in Anambra State boarding school will put these children at a disadvantage. This school provides an important social function in the community. They allow children to interact with their parents, make friends, and learn how to be part of the community. Boarding school can be very isolating and may not provide the same level of socialization. This school allows children to learn in a
every day on a daily basis. And all of those who live far distances, they may spend a lot of money, thousands within weeks, because they transport themselves. Think of a family of seven. The father dies out of frustration. He is thinking of where you get the money. Jesus beat the family. Moving forward, I also heard my opponent say that boarding school does not encourage extracurricular activity. Boarding school encourages them to develop their potentials, and these potentials can make them become someone in life. Unlike those students who are always confined and live within a strict rule, and live within a strict rule.
Abolishment of quota system in Nigeria by Mount Olive College, Omonia, with Progressive Comprehensive School, Ifeteduno, opposing it.
And we are the side proposition. We are here to propose motion which states that quota system should be abolished. I, as a lead speaker, would create the foundation of my team by defining the terms used in this debate and as well give out points that will, in fact, strengthen our stance, the stance created by me in the definition of the terms used in today's debate. My first supporting speaker will attack the arguments given to us by the lead speaker of the team opposition and as well as give out convincing points to further reaffirm the stance of my team. Well, my second supporting speaker will do justice to the watching points given to us by the poll.
Quota system may be seen from a negative perspective as a people, but may I remind you it has a high advantage for our country's development. Just like it has been said, charity begins at home. Quota system helps towards your state unemployment in the rural community. What do I mean? Imagine when a frame or industry is established in a place and the life of the villagers is from poverty to poverty. But with the end of quota practice, the villagers of such privilege will be considered for achieving employment. And this will definitely eradicate some bad or few behavior like God is for them. You are embraced by my team, raised and raised by my district from the team opposition. This proves that the team opposition is not ready for today's debate. The team opposition failed cite examples where this quota system has actually helped Nigeria, where it has created benefits, where it has provided, where it has aided or provided or helped in raising the economy of Nigeria. The greatest mistakes comes from not learning from other mistakes. Like Nigeria, the Titanic is sinking ship.
we need to jump out of this equation. Quota system has led to the failure of women in the political sector. In the political sphere, Nigeria has been forced to reserve seats, government positions to those women who are undesirable, those women who are incapable of having this position, all in the name of what? Trying to create balance, trying to promote gender equality.
To men, it's the office of president to elect or by voting. And yet we all are still talking about equality. The only way to talk about equality is to use the quota system and expect the position of president to those that are political disadvantage.
What's a substantial stance in today's debate? In our brief answer, several POIs have thrown at them, giving us a poor analysis on the points they raised in today's debate and an inability to cite proper examples on any of the points raised today. It is clear that the team opposition are not prepared for today's debate. The first speaker came up to tell us that quota system poses a greater advantage than its disadvantage without giving us a proper illustration, example, or any analysis on how this has on how this point is true. She did not give us any illustration on any way it's working in Nigeria and any advantage it has posed to Nigeria. Instead, she just came out here to lay her points and have not given us in any way which our quota system will do more beneficiary work than the merit system, which the team proposition are posing in today.
Some institutes for women, peace and security, had their research that indicates how quota system may be beneficial to men's civil liberties and access to justice. Now, if we all can be truthful, we will notice that there has never been a woman president in our country, and it is rare to also find a woman governor. All because we all believe that women has no room to break high political aspects. But may I tell you that scholars like Aristotle confirm that countries that elect more women are likely to have better progression outcomes.
If you are two quota system, which means that they have proposed that we should actually put those who are undesirable of the position into those positions because of quota system. Why? They have said that this will bring about development, bring about progress, bring about all this and that. Forgetting to take note that quota system actually brings those who are not qualified, not productive, ineffective, a chance to actually operate or handle those positions, which is leading to the day by day degradation of our economy.
Prosperity Learners Academy Mkpoago emerged the winner in the first debate, while Mount Olive College Umuya emerged winner in the third debate. This house will abolish capital punishment in Nigeria by Wanonwa Imo Secondary School Oka, while Mount Olive College Umuya opposed it.
We define capital punishment as the illegal legal killing of someone by a country. So, my team and my first supporting speaker will be taking us on legality, cruelty. Cruelty does not protect crime. Criminals can be used as levels when incapacitated. And then my second supporting speaker will be taking us on value of life, cruelty, retribution is wrong. Then I, as the lead speaker, will be taking us on lack of deterrence, stigmatization, inhuman, and it is medically unethical. Oh, lack of deterrence effect. When I say deterrence, what do I mean? I mean that according to Oxford Dictionary, you define deterrence as a thing that makes somebody less likely to do something. Those who believe that deterrence justifies execution of certain offenders bears the burden of proving that death penalty is a deterrent. Extreme brutalizing of people. It also violates the dignity of individuals and therefore contrary to human rights, which is that we have the fundamental human rights as the right to life. According to Chinua Achebe, to take a life when a life was lost is vengeance. And I will call death penalty a vengeance instead of justice.
I am the lead speaker of the opposing team and I'm here to give you reasons why we should not. The House should not abolish capital punishment. My second speaker is going to give further reasons why it should not be abolished. And the punishment is legally authorized, killing of someone as a punishment for a crime. And this leads me to my first point. So, crime should be on the same level as the punishment. Is our friendly co-debate was trying to tell us that if someone were to commit murder, that they should not be punished, they should not be killed for killing, for taking another person's right and right to life. And they're trying to tell us that if someone commits any level of crime, that they should all be given the same amount of punishment. If you ask me, I would say that this capital punishment is needed in order to punish criminals who commit high-level crimes.
Should not be abolished because of the following points. One, legality. It was even stated, it was even cited in the 1999 Constitution of Nigeria as amended in 2008 that everybody in Section 31, Chapter 5, that everybody has their own right to life. Even the unborn babies have their own right to life. And on this I stand that is highly illegal to take a life, be it by the government, be it by the individual. And it is this illegality that was found by various countries which led them to abolish capital punishment. Such countries are South Africa, in 6th of June 1995. We also have Italy, Brazil, Germany, etc. Then let's go to Africa. We also have Rwanda in 2007, Togo in 2009, Gabon in 2010, Benin Republic in 2012. Then most recently, we have Zambia and Central African Republic of 2022. Now, let me tell you, the question I want to ask you now is that, are you trying to tell me that what is it that Nigeria has not abolished capital punishment? Is it that Nigeria as a whole cannot afford to abolish capital punishment, while other countries are abolishing capital punishment?
In opposition, I would like to agree with statements made by the lead speaker and first supporting speaker of the opposition when they say that capital punishment deters crime. Yes, capital punishment deters crime. Because when people are accused for crimes, they tend to abstain. If, for example, if someone was murdered, and then the person that murdered the victim was killed, it will stop those in the society. It will stop those in the society from engaging in such crimes. For example, governments use capital punishments on terrorists in countries. If terrorists are caught and capital punishment is used, they are sentenced to death. Who else will have the mind to engage in such acts? Who else will have the mind to engage in terrorism?
I say in a situation whereby the government violates their own constitution by serving capital punishments to the citizens. If only the citizens will think that taking life is valuable, that taking life is easy, which will now make the citizens now to take life till death. The crime rate of Zambia have reduced by 5%, now making it a horror rate of 5.20%. What does this mean? The abolition of capital punishment just by a few months have reduced their crime rate up to 5%. Now, can we not see the difference between countries that are practicing capital punishment and countries that are still practicing capital punishment?
I'll start by refuting some of the points made by the proposition. The lead speaker from the proposition said that, and I quote, that according to Oxford Learner's Dictionary, that capital punishment is the legal killing of someone by a country. Now, since it is legal, why then are you against the capital punishment since it's legal? Now, from this point of mind, I hope that you declare victory in this meeting.
Life imprisonment, then they should be given life imprisonment. Then, as your best supporting speaker said, you said that in fact that someone robbed, that someone came and robbed and killed someone. But I'm a victim of that circumstance. Now when I was being robbed in my house, and then the criminals came and they robbed us, covered their face, and I'm still standing here, well alive. Nothing happened to me, nothing happened to any of my families. And then you are also saying that robbing, you said that murder, that we should kill the murderers, right? But do you mean that does it mean that raping the rapist is right? Is wrong, actually. Then it is quite appalling that in this time in Nigeria, that we are still arguing or protesting on whether capital punishment should be abolished or
The debate came to a close with a vote of thanks and closing prayers by Chijioke Ezulike.